Mechanics and Games.
And I'm Scott.
We just got 56 seconds.
On my watch.
We're the host of GeekNights. If you enjoyed this at all, grab one of those flyers. And today we're talking...
I guess you're nobody.
We're talking about quitting.
I just quit.
Yeah, that was the joke we came up with. We could not come up with a way to do that joke in a way that's actually funny.
Yeah, that's fine. I'll do it anyway.
The point of this panel, we're talking about quitting from a game theory and a game design perspective, is that quitting is an intrinsic property of games.
Right.
You cannot design a game that cannot be quit. If you can't quit it, it's not a game, it's real life.
Yeah, I mean, any game, any kind of game, no matter what definition of game you want to use, right, is a thing that is outside of actual real life. It is some made-up inner universe within the real world, right? And because we live in the real world, we can exit games.
Now, there's
by
some
definition.
There's some bleed-through, like harassment, there's all this stuff we'll talk about, but in terms of the game itself, the rules, any game you play at MAGFest, you can just walk away from the table.
People you can quit this panel. In fact, if you're not having fun, you probably should.
Yeah, but you can quit stuff. Professional sports, a football player could literally just be like, you know what, fuck it, and just walk out. Like, that could happen.
I mean, there are consequences for doing so, because real life is also a thing, but you can quit.
The game has to deal with
it. It is possible.
So this panel is we're going to explore quitting from a whole bunch of different angles. This is like quitting 101.
We're going to go every single thing there is to do with quitting, we're going to go into it.
Let's start with the bail. Quitting before the game. If you're out, if someone's doing something like, hey, we're going to play a game of Eclipse, and it's going to take 4 hours of starting at midnight. You look at your friend, you're like,
you know
what?
I got nothing to do with that.
I'm out.
Mm-mm.
Bailing is a refined skill of an enlightened human.
Now, you might argue that this sort of bailing before the game starts isn't quitting, right? Quitting is when you're in the game and then you exit the game, right? So, like, not even entering the game in the first place is sort of, like, not even quitting. It's sort of just, like, not playing.
Nope.
You know, but there's still a lot of things involved in that. You might bail on a game before it starts for a lot of the same reasons you might quit a game that's already happening. So it's still an important thing to keep in mind because it's very closely related.
And the important thing is, how close are you to the event horizon of the game? And it's different for every game. If a game takes 4 hours to set up, and then you're like, no, I'm not playing, yeah, you're not friends with those people anymore.
Right, even though the game didn't start yet, right, it's like you still, there's a certain point you reach where it's like, you are now in the game, congratulations.
But
right?
If halfway through tic-tac-toe, you're like, I can't do this.
Right, or maybe you sit down at a table at MAGFest, and someone's teaching you a game, and then you finish the explanation, and then you go, you know what, I don't want to play this. You didn't reach the point where, like, it's already turn five, right? You didn't cross that line where it's like, oh, you're already in it now.
But the important thing from a game design perspective is that games have to handle these situations because they will occur. And they can occur for a lot of reasons. You might, like, the bus just might not show up. Like, you're ready to play hockey, and the other team just isn't there. And you have to have rules around that. What do you do if the opponent doesn't show up?
Yeah.
What do you do if someone's kid vomits all over them while they're playing Overwatch and they quit your competitive game? That happened to me like a week ago.
But there's also things that are actually common and not ridiculous. Like, what if my computer explodes? Or what if my computer just, like, crashes? And, you know, or a lot of technological things. But non-technological things can happen, too. What if you're at MAGFest and the fire alarm goes off? Right? What if somebody...
Although you keep playing that game.
I'm just saying, what if somebody spills their drink on the table? Right? What if you're playing the game and you find out you're missing pieces? You know, it's not... It's sports we already went into, right?
Yep.
There's many, many reasons you could accidentally have to forfeit or quit or end a game
but prematurely. But this is specifically distinct from the intentional forfeit.
Mm.
So this is an interesting situation. This is a high school football team, American football, and because of a bunch of reasons we won't get into, all the kids on this team are monsters. They're like 280 pounds, like they're like big NFL burly people.
Right, this high school football team can compete with like crappy college football teams, right? Just because of the way their school system is set up, they were able to recruit all of these players into the same high school. And they're playing against other high schools who are just normal high schools, who have like one good player and a bunch of high school kids. And basically teams would forfeit the games against them because if they played them, they would get murdered.
Yep. Not just murder like, oh, we'll lose the game, which that might be a valid reason to forfeit, but like you'll get hurt. When I was in high school, if someone who weighed 280 pounds of muscle tried to hit me, I would die.
Right, and you're like a 90-year-old kid who's just playing football because you're not planning to make it a career, right? So you cannot put... It's like, you know, there's a reason you have weight classes in boxing. Weight classes in boxing are very small. It's like X pounds through not very many more pounds. It's very narrow, right? If you fight against someone who weighs like 10, 15, 20 more pounds than you, you are in deep shit. And you're gonna play football against someone who's 100 more pounds? No, it's not gonna happen.
Now, if one person quits a game before, they forfeit the game for some reason, that's one thing. But then, if there's a mass forfeit, if you're not just quitting for your own reasons, but you're quitting because of other extrinsic reasons, that turns into a boycott. Mm-hmm. The 1980 Summer Olympics, half the world didn't show up for a lot of reasons related to Afghanistan. So the Olympics had to deal with this. The Olympics happened anyway. The U.S. wasn't there. Half the world wasn't there. And, you know, the rules of the game or whatever. But that is something that can happen. Imagine if NFL players decided to stop playing because the game's dangerous.
Right, yeah. There are many, many instances in history, especially with the Olympics, of political boycotts, right? But in professional sports, players haven't sat out too often. You know, usually it's a lockout. Yeah. But there have been quite a few strikes in professional sports. You know, bring in replacement players in the NFL and stuff like that. So, you know, there's labor reasons, political reasons, and many other reasons that someone would not play a game for, you know, an intentional preemptive forfeit.
But we're going to really focus on the intentional quitting, the stuff you're expecting. You're in the middle of a game, someone flips over the table and walks away. So the only questions that matter when someone quits an ortho game, meaning an actual competitive game, like we're
a game that has a winner and a loser, not like D&D where it's sort of like it's just you're playing, but there's not, you know.
Yep. Can the game continue after this player has quit, and can a winner be determined? So for example, this is something that happened on June 4th, 1974. There was an event, the Cleveland Indians game, called 10 Cent Beer Nights.
Now, it was 1974. 10 cents was a lot more money then than it is now.
But not that much money.
It's still 10 cents. That's like, whoa, right? So imagine if it was 10 Cent Beer MAGFest.
Can any of you imagine a situation that might occur at such a night that might prevent a game of baseball from continuing? Oh, well, look what happened. The audience, like, attacked the players. Like, the players had to form this, like, ring with baseball bats. Like, both teams defending each other, trying to get the hell out of Dodge.
Right, it's like, you go to a baseball game nowadays, and, like, there'll be two drunk guys way up in the top level, and they'll have a fight, and security will take them out, right? But imagine if, like, half the stadium was that guy.
So, what happened here? Basically, this happened, the police were like, we ain't getting anywhere near that, and they just left. So, the umpires were like, yeah, you know what? This game can't continue. Based on the rules of baseball, the home team forfeits, away team wins,
It's the home team's fault for not controlling their stadium, right? And their audience, so they lose.
So, baseball has rules about that. If the game cannot be continued, there is an official, specific way to determine who won if the game could not be continued. And in fact, the rules are interesting. So, if you win a game like this, or lose a game like this, the stats, like how many hits, how many pitch strikes, how many pitches, all that stuff, are as they were when the umpires decided the game was beyond the event horizon where it couldn't return to a playable state. The score is recorded, for historical purposes, as 9-0. So, because it's almost like when you're writing code. Like, you write a function, it has some output. If your function fails, it still has to have the expected output, so the rest of the season of baseball will work as intended. So you can't just have this game that returns a null pointer exception. If I want to find out what the score was because some future term we use like goal differential, I'm thinking of hockey. They use some sort of metric using those numbers. This game has to have all the stats that a full game would have had. It's 9-0 because there are 9 innings. If you play high school baseball that has 7 innings, it's 7-0. They think about these things.
Is it usually like 6 innings in high school games?
I think it's 7.
I don't know.
Pretty sure. I don't like baseball. I don't.
Still nine.
All right. What about a single player game? Like you're playing Doom at home.
You can just quit whenever the hell you want. No one cares.
Yeah.
There's no other people involved. Whatever.
I'll win later. The only consequence is I quit. So cool.
Single player. I gotta go eat lunch. I'll play again some other time.
Yeah. Overwatch Quick Play. This happens a lot. We'll talk a lot about Overwatch in this panel.
Because that's the game Rim's playing, so he's going to make every example with that.
So in Quick Play, the game can... I mean, D.Va, I play this game a lot. You can just continue, because what the game does is it finds some poor sucker who's solo queuing and says, hey, this game where someone quit, we're going to throw you into the middle of it, and everyone's going to hate you, and it's going to be miserable. Good luck, have fun.
Right.
But the other team usually doesn't notice. At most, they think, wow, that D.Va that was really giving me trouble isn't here anymore. All right, I guess they switched to that garbage Hanzo. Cool.
Right, so in a lot of games, right, you know, this would be a problem, right? So in Counter-Strike, if someone leaves, like, they don't really replace them, and it's like you're in big trouble, right? In Left 4 Dead, you get the situation where, you know, people quit the losing team, and now the losing team is disadvantaged, and then random people join the losing team, and because they're on the losing team, they quit, and you basically have one team that people keep joining and leaving, and it keeps losing forever, and the other team sticks together because because they keep winning against this nothing team.
And then they win more and more and more, while anyone who decides, I'll play some Left 4 Dead, just joins this, like, miserable team of horrible cockbats.
Until it's some maybe miraculous thing happens, and four good people join the other team simultaneously and manage to get a win, and then the other team starts losing people in that, right? Yeah.
But casual games, if it's not, like, a super competitive thing, they'll do stuff like that. They'll backfill, they'll support another player, and they'll do something so that even if the game is suspect, like, the team that won or lost might not be the most skilled team that should have won or lost, but the game does continue with the minimal impact to the other players. But in competitive, where, like, stats matter and, like, this is a serious game, that doesn't fly. So they need to have, like, all these really specific rules about, like, if a player quits, it's going to count as a loss for you, but you are welcome to quit because that other player quit. Like, you don't have to play this losing game. You are allowed to continue it because maybe you're so good, like, you might still win. Like, it gives you that option, but it is explicit what is going to happen. It doesn't hide it. You don't wonder where that Hanzo went. You know that Hanzo quit.
Right. Rocket League does something pretty similar, right? It's like someone leaves your team, and it's like, okay, someone left your team. It wasn't you. We're going to punish them for just leaving the serious game, semi-serious game, you know, but you can quit if you want to without penalty. But if the other people, if you still win, okay, you still win, you know.
Carcassonne, a little board game. A lot of your friends are playing this convention. Carcassonne turns out okay. Like, if someone quits,
official rules in the rule book about quitting. Technically, it's like, you
gotta put an asterisk next to it.
But because the game is structured in such a way, you can actually deal with someone quitting pretty elegantly if you want to.
Now, it depends on how skilled players are. If you're, like, not super competitive about this game, just keep going. Just that other player, just they don't take any more actions, and it'll work out fine. Like, the game will be fine.
It means that any player who stays in the game is gonna get a few more tiles, because that, you know, let's say there are five players, you each get 20% of the tiles. If someone leaves, you're now gonna get 25% of the remaining tiles.
So if you were an advanced player who, say, was building a smaller set of structures because you knew how many tiles you'd get, because you, like, you know the odds, suddenly, like, that ruins the game for you. So if you're, like, super competitive, game over, quit. But if you're just playing this for fun, you can just keep playing. It totally works out.
Yeah.
So that does raise another interesting question of the third question you have to ask isn't just, can a winner be determined? Because, yeah, we can determine a winner in all these situations, but does that win count? I would not count any win in any game I played where 100% of the rules weren't followed. But that is me. You might not care that much. But I want to put that little asterisk next to my name in the Hall of Fame if I lose a game because it's a bunch of Hanzos keep cycling
in. It also
in.
Depends count for what, right? It's like, does it count enough that I can brag to my friends that I beat them that one time? And they'll say, no, someone quit that game, it's like, no. Whatever, you didn't really, right? Can I become the world champion of Carcassonne? It's like, no, you can't. It needs to be much more strict and according to the rules in order for you to be the world champion of Carcassonne. We're going to have to replay that game or do something, right?
So a better question to ask, especially if you're a game designer, isn't does the win count, but was the game satisfying? Mm. The players at the end, when a score is determined, are they okay with that? Do they feel like the game was still worth playing, or are they just angry that you ruined the game by quitting on them?
Right, there are a lot of times, like the Carcassonne, right, where you could play the game, and someone quit, but you all kept playing with the remaining tiles, and that person's final score was just the score they had when they left, right? And it's like, you finished the game, you played it, and it's like, that could be a satisfying game finish. It's like, you're not upset by that unless you really, really care about that, like, asterisk, right? And it's like, you still had a fully enjoyable game that you began, middle, and ended. So what's the problem?
Yeah. So some more examples now, thinking about those questions. Some complicated 4-hour-long board game. Because of all these fiddly little bits here, and because the game is so complex, if Joey Jojo quits the game 2 hours in, there is basically no way to recover from that at all. You can't just ignore that player, because suddenly, like, say, like, Joey Jojo's between the two of us, and it's a giant map, the two of us are going to move in on that dead player's territory.
But meanwhile, someone else who's not near that empty territory doesn't have that opportunity. They weren't just handed, like, all this territory for free, right? So that's, like, that's not fair at all. It just totally messes, there's no way the game can continue in
like,
a fair
all these
way.
Numbers, all the numbers of things that go around are determined by the number of players. So, like, that's all messed up now. The game's getting at a weird point. And even worse, say you find a friend who also knows the rules of this game and says, oh, I'll take over for that player. With Carcassonne, that's totally fine. You can sit down at a Carcassonne game at any point, look at the board, and after a minute have a good sense of what the strategy was. good luck figuring out what Joey Jojo was trying to do in this game. It'll take you hours to figure out the state of the game, because you weren't learning it turn by turn for the last 2 hours.
Right, and maybe you were really friendly with the player who left. Like, you had an alliance, and now this new player is, like, someone you're not so friendly with, and they're like, they want to attack you, and it's like, oh, great, that thing that I had moved my strategy to not attack him, and all my ships are over here, and now suddenly that is changed randomly into an aggressor, and my ships are out of position.
Yeah, or, like,
fantastic.
you know Joey Jojo sucks at the game, and you're like, you're banking on that, and suddenly Scott takes over Joey Jojo, and now you're in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
How about a long-form RPG? That's our D&D group from, like, 15 years ago. I've been using this picture for over a decade. I don't know if they know. I've told some
most
of them.
Most of those people are here?
Yeah, most of those people are at this MAGFest.
But the two people at the bottom...
That's Scott right there.
Hair, don't have hair anymore?
Yeah, look at that.
Anyway, so, it, you know, this really depends on, like, the kind of game you got going on, right? Maybe you got, like, a tight group, and you've got, like, the minimum number of players, and you lose someone. Now you don't have enough players to form the party, and it's hard to continue, because it's really boring to play an RPG with, like, a GM and, like, one or two people, right?
Yep.
You need three, hopefully four is really good, right? Now even down to three is sketchy. And that could be a problem. You know, maybe this player, maybe you can write them out of the story, like, oh, they died. That you can get their character out of there. That's not really much of a problem. But what if their character was, like, the focus of the quest that you were on? Like, you know, it's Final Fantasy and, like, you know, the magical girl who was the whole important thing in the story. Well, she's gone. It's like, what? Now there's no reason for us to continue on this quest without that person.
And because you've
played
this game...
Make them an NPC and the GM takes care of them.
But then because you've played this game over so long, like, there's a lot of investment. If anyone takes over a character in something like that, or even in a Civ game, even a competitive game, you're like, I'm playing a, like, year-long civilization game with giant multiplayer robot. Like, I just got communism. Like, stuff started to really heat up in this game. If someone else joins that game, the narrative shifts suddenly. Like, suddenly someone like the DM is not going to play that magical girl the same way the first person was. So the person who quit will now possibly be mad at you for ruining their OC. Mm-hmm. Like, social consequences occur. Mm-hmm. What about raid games? What about WoW? You got a WoW group. You've got N people to play the raids, and then one of those people quits.
All right, well, it's fine if it's just some sort of, like, hanger-on who's, like, barely contributing, right? But it's like, the healer is gone. We cannot continue. What do we do, right?
Nope.
It's like we have a whole team of people, and everyone's got a role, and one of the people is gone, and we can't find a replacement. Uh-oh.
But think about this long-term. Once you've lost that person, you can't keep doing the gaming you were doing up to this point. Say you do a raid every weekend, you got your team, your friends, your fun, and suddenly someone just quits on that because they have a baby or get married or something dumb like that. Then now... You've got to, what are you going to do, like, audition healers? Which, yeah, that's kind of what people do. Like, they audition people to join their raid group sometimes. But, like, it could disrupt your routine of playing games as opposed to disrupting an individual instance of a game. Like, this has wrecked people's summers.
I mean, you know, this can happen outside of games, too, right? All right, we're going to go on a road trip, and the person with the driver's license quit. And now what?
So, this is probably the most interesting part of this panel. Why do people quit games? Because you can boil these down to a pretty small set of categories. Primarily, the game's not that interesting to them. They're bored for some reason.
Right, you know, maybe people had an idea of what the game was going to be when they started. You know, people's feelings change based on the world, right?
Yeah.
You know, things can happen over the course of play to where they decided to play it at the beginning. They said, I'm playing this. They start playing. And then during the game, at some point, it's like they do not want to continue because they don't feel like it. They're not enjoying themselves. They're upset maybe about something else. Who knows?
Maybe they're not winning, or they don't feel like they could win, and there isn't anything interesting for them to do. Like, the mechanical actions in the game are boring to them unless they have a chance of winning. Maybe it's your friend who's really into, like, Shageek. And Marge here is like, oh, man, we're going to play Shageek. And she's really into it.
She never played Shageek before. She doesn't know. She doesn't know. It's bad.
And culturally, like you've been in this boat. You've been in a game that's boring and you keep playing out of social obligation. How freeing would that be? To just walk away from the table and let them deal with it. You can be in the arcade in 5 minutes at MAGFest, or you're in the four-hour game of Eclipse that you realize is actually going to take 6 hours because Joey Jojo won't take his turn.
Now, maybe you're a jerk for just leaving, but maybe they're a jerk for making you stay when you don't want to play, right? Who knows?
You've got to calibrate, like, your bail threshold in life. Not just in games, but in life. I bail at, like there's a gust of wind. I'm like, I'm out. I'm done. This game. I'm not playing this game.
Like, a feather will move a little bit, and Rim's like, I quit.
the game just goes on too long and now your candy's gone.
Right. So sometimes when this happens, it's because the game is just longer than you thought it would be from the beginning. But
especially when friends lie and say, oh, Caverna, yeah, it takes like a half hour to play.
But maybe the game does take a half hour to play and the people playing it are slow, right? But another thing that can happen is a lot of games, the one that most people would understand would be Monopoly, where the game is over, but it's not officially over, right? It's like someone's got all the properties and all the hotels, but the game officially ends when everyone else is bankrupt. So you're going to have to sit there for another hour rolling dice just to find out what you already knew, which is the person who had hotels all over the board is going to win. But you couldn't declare them the winner, right?
Yep.
So some games get this right, the best example being tennis, where if you're playing tennis, you have a chance to win, and as soon as you have no chance to win, it's match point, and someone scores the match point, the game ends immediately. So if you're playing, you can win, and if you're not playing, you can't win. There's a lot of games where you could be playing them, and it's not officially over, but effectively you have already lost, but you're still sitting there playing, and it's going too long, right? The game should end as soon as only one person can win.
And sometimes it ends up being extrinsic, like, you wouldn't necessarily quit the game, but your friend said it's going to take an hour, they're taking their turns real slow, it takes an hour and a half, and you got to be at, like, the Nidhogg tournament in 10 minutes, and you just have to leave.
Mm-hmm.
The game is not what you expected. Your friends are like, this is going to be a mech battling German style game, and it ends up being this BSC diplomacy game, Skype. Scythe.
So, yeah, that game's not good. But yeah, there's tons of games out there where on the surface look like one thing, but are actually another thing. A lot of people get fooled by themes of games, which I have managed to not be fooled by that. Where, like, they'll look at a game and be like, oh, it's the Mega Man game. I love Mega Man. I'll play that game. But it's like a garbage game. It just happens to have pictures of Mega Man plastered onto it, right? You know, it's like they get fooled into thinking it's something they're going to like. And then once they play it, they learn the reality, which is it's something that they don't like.
Yep.
So, you know, when games falsely advertise or cover themselves up with, like, fancy art that doesn't represent what the game actually is, this happens a lot. So, rather than finish the game, you might want to quit it early once you have learned and seen the truth with your own eyes.
The game is unfair, or the game is perceived to be unfair. No one wants to play against cheaters. If you're playing hockey and you suspect that, like, the other team stuck an extra puck out and, like, did some nonsense, you're not going to come back on the ice. You're just going to go home.
Yeah, there's no point. Someone else is aimbotting, like the suspect, who I suspect is aimbotting.
I think the three wall headshots.
The four.
Four wall headshots.
Right. So, you know, what's the point of playing with this person? There isn't one. You might as well just quit if you can't kick them out, right? But there are other times where someone's not cheating, but it's still just as pointless, right? If I was going to play basketball against Michael Jordan or LeBron.
He don't need to cheat.
They don't need to cheat. Perfectly following the rules of basketball, I would never touch the basketball. It would just put, right? It would be up there somewhere, and I would be like, right? And that would be, they'd put it in the basket, and I would do nothing, right? And there's no point in me playing against them. It's not like I'm going to suddenly grow a foot taller and be able to compete. It's not like I'm suddenly going to get twice as strong and be able to compete. It's just not going to happen no matter how hard I try. So better off to do something else with my time.
Now, in serious competition, this is an extra problem because you're competing, so you actually care about the outcome of the game, win or lose. So if you feel like someone has an unfair advantage, and this will especially happen in esports when there's a glitch and there isn't a rule to handle the glitch. Mm-hmm. So, like, right now, there's a problem in Overwatch where there's two maps where you can get outside of the map and just have a grand old time and kill the other team whenever you want. It's not clear, officially, whether or not that is allowed, because the game allows
you to. I'm pretty
sure
if there was a serious tournament, they'd be like, anyone who leaves the map, your team loses that match, right? It's like, just don't do it.
Yeah, but
or they would patch it if it's an official
tournament.
It'll
get patched, I assume, pretty quick. But you're not going to play against someone who is cheating because you don't want to legitimize the outcome of that game.
Right. Often you'll see an amateur or, you know, less than the top tier of competition, people put in mercy rules, right, to sort of enforce the quitting. Like, okay, make it stop, right? If the suspect wasn't cheating and the other people can't even compete, it's like, all right, we're not going to make you keep playing. It's just over.
But there's also a more weird problem that you'll see, especially in online play, where you are playing the game and the other players are beating you, and you think they're cheating because you just actually really suck at the game. Mm. And it's not that you recognize, like, oh, Michael Jordan's way better than me. Like, you think he is cheating. You believe that you would beat him, but he is breaking some rule of physics, I guess, and clipping through the walls, and, like, whatever it is that he's doing. And I've been kicked. When I used to play Counter-Strike, back when I was young enough to move my mouse that fast to get my corners, like, I would play Counter-Strike semi-competitively, and I would get kicked from servers for cheating because I got too many headshots. I wasn't doing that. I was just playing. And that happens. That's actually kind of a problem. This is the technical term in the industry.
So, you know, we talked just now about people sort of, you know, being upset and wanting to quit because they were being, like, destroyed, right? The other people were much better than them and they were losing, right? But there are many other reasons that you might have the butthurt rage, even if your competition is weaker than you or equal to you, you know, has nothing to do with them, right? For example, maybe there's a lot of random things in the game and just one of the random things just bites you and it's nothing broke. It's just like you drew a really bad card in a card game or the dice came up snake eyes and it's just like, what's the point in life? Why did I even try? Why did I put all this effort in if it all came down to this stupid dice roll that ruined me, right? You're just mad.
And these are the situations where quitting is actually probably the best case scenario for that player because now they're gone and you don't have to deal with them and you can play a new game. Mm-hmm. But this is also the level where players will lash out. They may not quit, but just grief the game. They will say, you know what, I'm going to make Scott win because F you all, and just take actions to make Scott win, to make the game unsatisfying, hoping that you will quit because you suck. Or they'll mess up the state of the game so that you can't continue, you can't even calculate the score.
It can happen a lot in games of diplomacy, right? If people just decide to gang up on you, right? And it's just like, now you're mad because it's like everyone's just ganging up on you. So, like, you're upset about that if you take it personally and not just as a game thing, right? You know, there's many, many reasons that people with, you know, even people who don't have anger issues might get mad and not want to play a game anymore because of things that happened in it.
So, there's a story, we've talked about this in other panels, we'll talk about it a little bit in the panel during tomorrow, too, but there's a gentleman and his friends, their goal was to
What's
get...
What's his name again?
I don't even remember. He plays Hanzo. Hanzo, spelled wrong. This is Overwatch.
His
goal was to be the lowest... ranked player in the world.
He's losing on purpose.
But he's losing on purpose while trying to give the appearance of trying really hard to win. And he wrote this great like interview and essay of like all the like situations that occurred. But he talked a lot about there's this area in like the bottom third, like not the bottom of people who like don't know D.Va can fly, but like in this middle zone of people who he said they are, quote, the angriest people in the world.
Right. They know how to play the game, right? It's like they're not like someone who's like playing Mario and doesn't know that Mario can fly with the tail, right? It's like they understand the game. They know how to control the game. They're competent. They just suck. Like, their aim is bad, they don't move and shoot at the same time, you know, they don't have the techniques, they just have the competency, right? And they feel like they should be good at the game because they know what the hell they're doing, they understand the rules, and they're trying hard, but they're not improving at all, because I guess, I think they might improve if they had coaching that would teach them technique, but
some people are just unsalvageable.
Maybe,
right?
Or maybe they're just bad at learning, who knows, there's something with those people, right? And they're so angry because they feel like they're better than they are, and their score and rank does not reflect what they feel their rank should be based on what they know, because they don't know what they don't know.
And it's extra hurtful to them because these ranks are mathematically determined and pretty reasonably objective. So the game says you're this rank, you're that rank. Like, you might be a little better or a little worse, but you're down there. And it just so happens that, like, the middle third of the left side of the bell curve is where all of those people are. That's, like, the sweet spot. I guess the opposite of the sweet spot. And it's a very specific situation. They feel entitled to winning, and they don't understand why they're not winning. They feel like they're better at the game than they are. They don't understand the actual heuristics of the game, and they're not getting better. There's not much you can do about these people. Like, I don't know what to do, but matchmaking actually makes them matter.
Yeah. But these people are likely to quit is the point, right?
Yep.
It's when you're in that situation, quitting becomes a thing that's going to happen. You know, you're going to want to quit more because you're not getting the results you expect based on your perceived performance. And that is going to make you more mad than, say, someone who's really good and loses because that person knows why they lost because they can see what's going on, right? And, you know, or someone who's just so bad they know they're bad or barely understands the game, right, doesn't have this sort of idea that they're like, oh, yeah, I suck, I lose, right?
Like, once you get beyond that part of the bell curve, like, there's this good-humored fun of, like, yeah, we're all bad at this game, but we're trying. We'll make it someday. So... talking about real life, yes, games are 100% extrinsic to reality, except that there's racist shitbags all over the internet, and they show up in your games.
Yeah, so you don't need to play with them.
But at the same time, this is a huge reason why people quit games. I quit Overwatch games if someone's being weirdly sexist or weirdly racist. I report them first, but then I quit the game. Like, I won't play with those people. We'll talk a little about mitigating this later, but this is a real and serious reason why people quit games, and it's one of the few reasons to quit games is actually pretty justified. Like, you should never have to tolerate that kind of crap playing a game.
Right. It's like people sort of have this obligation, whether it's like a board game in person or a video game, that, like, you know, without one of those other reasons we've talked about or will talk about soon, you know, it's like they feel like they should keep playing a game to the end. You started the game, you're somewhat obligated to finish it, but it's like, wouldn't it be much better if any time there was someone who was bad, if we just quit the game and now those people couldn't find anyone to play with? It's like to punish them, right? Why should we reward them by providing them the fun of having friends to play with? That's not a person that should have friends, right? So if they're playing a game, just quit it. Just, right? Force them to be alone. If you're sitting at a table in MAGFest and you're playing games with some MAGFest people, who I don't think any MAGFest people should be like this, but in case there is, just everyone get up and walk away. Right? Don't let them have fun. They don't deserve it. Right?
Stopping points. Sometimes you'll quit a game because you're just invested in the game, you're playing it, you're doing your thing, and you lose track of time. That serotonin is rushing through your brain, and you're just like, you know, you'll play literally forever, but then the game gives you a cue that says, okay, like it pauses, you back away for a second, and you remember you're in the real world, and you look and see the clock, or like you look and see your friends, and you're like, all right, I live in a real world, and maybe I could do something different. Because no one quits a game suddenly. No one quits a game. You're not playing Doom, and in the middle of fighting a cyber demon, you're just like, fuck it, and just turn the game off and go to bed.
Right, you kill the cyber demon, you pull the exit switch, and it goes, and then you're like, all right, good, I can just save the game here.
There's two kinds of stopping points. Extrinsic stopping points are outside of the game.
It's time for dinner. This panel's over. It's time for MAGFest.
Yep.
The bus is coming.
There's a reason why in
I need to pee.
In Civilization games, that's why I quit that panel early a little while ago. In Civilization games, there's an option to put a real-world clock just in the game. So you don't forget.
I think a lot of games lately are including the real world clock because they're PC games especially, because the PC games will cover up your Windows clock. You're not using a Mac to play games. You know, like Hearthstone puts the clock in the corner, even on the iPad it puts the clock in the corner, right? Civilization puts it in the top right, and I love this. This is great because you can easily forget, especially the longer the game is, what the hell time it is, because you're not looking at anything else.
When I used to play Civ 2, like more than once, I would look out the window like, what's that light? I would literally see dawn approaching.
Not good. And I mean, it's more serious than you think, right? There are people, especially like in countries with a more net cafe kind of culture, who like have died or have had serious health issues from sitting there for too long, and a clock may have saved them? Maybe?
Or like, you know, life comes at you fast, like Father Time is undefeated. Eventually, you're going to stop playing a game. You might quit the long form. Like, people who play any sport will eventually be too old to play that sport. I'm already too old to play Overwatch and Counter-Strike.
I pretty much can't play a real-time game seriously and competitively anymore, even though I was doing the best at Quick 1 yesterday. But
you were crushing me,
not,
I don't know why.
Not against anyone who's any good. I'm old. I'm like going to be 34, 35, right? So my arm cannot aim good.
Now, this is more like high-level meta. This isn't like quitting an instance of a game. This is like quitting the game itself. Like, I will never play Civilization again.
I'm tired of spending money on these magic cards. I'm not playing this anymore.
Yep. I'm 40 and I'm a human and I'm playing hockey. There have been humans who played hockey after 40.
I'm 50 years old. I can't keep playing these Pokemon games. It's just too creepy. It was okay when I was 40. But 50, too much.
But it's nothing in the game prompts you. Real life rings a bell and says, it's time. Intrinsic stopping points. You play Doom until you die or you see that screen.
And that 100% is all the way. What?
I found this screenshot. This is not me.
It could be shopped. Yeah. It's all the pixels.
So games, especially single-player games, especially in earlier eras where people didn't put as much rigor into studying games, were sort of be designed to be addictive by accident.
Right. I mean, you can view quitting as like a problem to solve, right? If you are the maker of a game, you know, or someone who's trying to get people to play a game, like if you're the GM and people are quitting on you, that's a problem you're trying to solve. You want to prevent quitting, right?
So you start like slipping cocaine into their drinks.
Right, so here's one of the first and earliest ways that video game designers at least tried to prevent quitting, which is, you know, to warn people like, hey, are you sure you want to quit, babies? Oh, you suck so much? Are you sure you suck? Oh, okay, you suck. Go back to that DOS prompt, sucky man.
Anyone know what game this is from?
Wolfenstein.
Yes.
Okay, good.
So modern games do this on purpose. They will string along rewards to get you to keep playing.
It's like, all right, you just leveled up. That could be a stopping point. You just got a level, but hey, you know, let me tell you about this quest you might want to go on. I'll give you, like, mad XP if you go on this quest right now.
Yep.
It's a limited time quest. I don't know if you come back later, I might not be here. You know, that's just how I do.
You did just level up, and you got a loot box, but you've got a bunch of experience now toward the next level, and we're during a winter event, so if you get another loot box, it's a special loot box. And by the way, you're getting 20% more XP because you are playing consecutive games. My solution to this is I don't open loot boxes, and my friends hate me for it.
How many unopened loot boxes do you have?
I have 24 unopened loot boxes right now.
Is that a lot? That doesn't seem like a lot. When it gets to, like, the thousands, that's when you should be like, in Hearthstone?
Well, I opened a few winter ones because I wanted
In Hearthstone, I do the quests every day, and I don't spend the gold. I just have, like, mountains of gold. It's good. I'm going to have so much gold soon.
But you've got to recognize that there are games, like, this, like the clock in Civ 5. If you were a naive game designer or an evil game designer, you would not include that clock. You want player. You would think the heuristic of my game is good is my players play it longer. He played it until death. It's a real good game. Or you might be evil and literally be thinking, if I get them addicted to this free-to-play game, I can extract money from them later. So what do we do about quitters?
Like, well, we just talked about two ways to do something about quitters. Don't prevent them from quitting. Right? But no, this is solutions to quitters. Like, if someone has already quit, then what do you do?
Yep. So, one, you mitigate it. So, there's a lot of ways to do this, and the idea, the reason I use the word mitigation is very specific. Because, like, in DevOps, or, like, IT, or, like, production operations out there in engineering, mitigation is the idea that there are problems, or errors, or mistakes that are guaranteed to occur eventually.
At some point, bad things will happen, and we can't prevent them from happening, that'd be prevention, and we can't completely erase the consequences, but we can diminish the consequences as much as possible. So, what will we do, and how will we do it?
You mitigate the damage. Carcassonne, we talked about before, does this in a bunch of ways. Like, the game can kind of just continue. If you're playing it online, it can just throw an AI in to take over the players. So you can just keep playing the game exactly as it was
before.
That's
not a perfect solution, but it's kind of, it's a mitigation, right? It's like, alright, you know, there's an AI, the game's sort of going still. Good.
But you do something. You have escalating punishment to prevent people from doing it. So in Overwatch, if you quit a game, it's like, fine, you can leave. But if you keep quitting games, if they, even casual games, it'll eventually be like, yo, you've quit a lot of games. So if you quit this one that you're trying to quit right now, we're taking away all those loot boxes. You're getting a 75% XP penalty until we see fit to let you have that back. That is a terrifying scream. And you will occasionally find people on Reddit who see it for the first time and panic. And it will eventually, it's almost like hitting someone to prevent them from doing something so they'll be afraid of being hit in the future. Proportional punishment is different. Quitting a quick play game, yeah, they only punish you if you do it all the time. Quitting a competitive game ruins an hour for everybody. So if you quit competitive games, they ruin your life. They will eventually
be suspended from competitive play up to receiving a ban for the entire season. Alright, that sucks, I guess, if you really want to play this game.
They'll suspend you, and then they'll ban you.
Right, if you quit, you better be quitting the game for good. Like, I'm just not playing Overwatch anymore.
Yeah.
Alright, then you won't care about this penalty.
Yep. De facto graceful exits. Like we said with Carcassonne, Factory Fun is another great example of this. This game, just mechanically the way it's designed, if one or two or three, as long as at least one player has not quit, the game is literally unaffected by this. You can just keep playing. There is no mechanical effect to that.
Right, and this is the best games that do this, the games that do this the best are the games that are effectively races, right? Where players are independently doing something that doesn't really interact with each other very much, right? Like, think about an actual foot race. If someone just stops running, it's like, fuck it. Doesn't affect everyone else, right? It's who's the fastest runner. If everyone quits, okay, that one person who didn't quit wins. Great. You know, so there's a lot of board games and other video games that are effectively just races. Like, who can get the most points? And you're not really doing anything to each other. And if someone just decides to stop playing, it's like, I guess they didn't get the most points. Unless maybe they're badass and they got the most points and they quit and everyone else keeps running, but they still win.
So much more difficult, and it is hard to find real examples of this. de jure or de jure quitting.
I fold.
Meaning, you are allowed, per the rules of the game, to quit the game, either within like a round or an action in the game, or quit the entire game, and the rules cover that.
Yeah, I'm just gonna take my money and cash out, because I won, so.
The rules here don't say you can quit, but you effectively can quit. The rules of poker are, I can just leave the table in the casino with my money, if I want to, and that is fine. Now, the tournaments are different. You can't just walk away from the poker tournament and keep your money.
Yeah, they take your money. But you can quit playing and you can fold a hand, right?
In general, if you're reading the rules, especially to a tabletop game, and you see specific rules for if a player quits, that is probably a very well-designed game because it is so extremely rare that even pro game designers consider this possibility. I was hard-pressed to find examples, and most of the examples, I asked, like, some listeners and friends, like, can you come up with examples? Almost every example they gave me did not actually have rules. They just mistakenly thought it had rules because they've done it before and it worked, but the rules didn't say anything about it. Mm-hmm. Some games will do this on, like, a whole game level, like a Glory to Rome, the Chudik game. There's a rule in the book that says, at any time, if all of the players unanimously agree that one of the players has won the game, you can stop right then and there. So you could just vote to say, yeah, this is over.
And
just
it's like,
end this.
You could just do that in any game. You could be playing the game of life and just be like, do we decide that Scott wins? Yeah, okay, we're done, right? Scott wins. And then I would win. But it doesn't say that in the rules. Just putting something in the rules makes a huge difference, right? Look at something like, you know, Hearthstone, which has the concede button, which it basically just says, I lose, you win, right? But just making that official, whereas rather than like making people disconnect or kill themselves, like makes such a huge difference. People quit and concede all the time. It's like you're supposed to concede. It's just like, yeah, I concede all over the place. Because they made it official, it's totally cool. Like no one's like, oh, too much conceding going on here, right? But if they didn't have that button and people were just like closing down their games and doing other things to quit, people would be like, oh, we got a rage quitting problem going on here.
Yep.
Just by making it official and not, you know, giving someone the win, everything's all good.
This is also important, back to that harassment thing. If you give someone an official, like, approved, like, this is a socially okay thing to do option, it's an escape hatch for someone who wants to quit a game because horrible people are playing with them. But if it were, say, Overwatch, there's no, like, official way to do it. Like, you're the jerk who quit the game. Even though it's not true, it allows a false equivalency of you did something bad and they did something bad. If there's an official way to quit, you did nothing wrong and no one can fault you. Some games kick you out if you're doing too bad.
So that's not necessarily quitting, right? That's being eliminated.
But it's a player who probably would quit, or if they didn't quit, they wanted to quit, they're bored.
Right, the other thing is that a game that has rules for player elimination, you can almost always use those rules for quitting as well. You just say, oh, you quit? We're going to do the same thing to you that would happen if you got eliminated, right? If someone destroys all your pieces on the board and Axis and Allies, then this happens to you. So if you want to quit a game of Axis and Allies, just remove all your pieces from the board and we'll follow the, you know, these other rules.
You're basically preemptively rage quitting someone before they realize they're mad. Because, like, Monopoly, you're mad because you know you can't win, but the game's going on forever and your friends won't just end it. But if Monopoly is like, yeah, dog, you can't win, you are free to leave this table and enjoy the rest of your life. How good does that feel?
In Age of Steam, I played it once. I made it to, like, the third turn, and then I didn't have any money, so it just made me stop playing.
I was eliminated the next turn, so.
Right, it's just like, oh, you're done. And it didn't make me continue to play the remaining 10 turns of the game in a game I couldn't win.
Incentives. So again, back to Overwatch. Overwatch gives you all these incentives to keep playing the game. Even if you're losing and it sucks, if you play to the end, you're going to get all that experience from the game to get the loot boxes.
You can get the loot box by losing?
Yeah, you get experience points every game, whether or not you win or lose. You just get more if you win. Mm. So there is a reason to keep playing. There's a reason to keep trying, because you also want to show up here. It feels great when it shows up here and says, yeah, you did the best healing. Yeah, you were the coolest dude. Yeah, you were Reaper and whatever. So it's just there. And some games do it even just with fun stuff, like Super Meat Boy. It might be 4 a.m. You really want to go to bed, but you know that if you beat the level, you get to see the 10,000 Meat Boys that failed coalescing into the one Meat Boy who lived. You really want to see that. It gives you an incentive to not quit. This is relatively recent, this type of thing.
They've been getting better at it, right?
Yeah.
But basically, yeah. Instead of, you know, look at the penalties the other games were using, like, oh, we're going to give you less XP, we're going to ban you from playing the game because you rage quit too much. It's like, we're going to change your profile icon so everyone knows that you suck and you keep quitting when you're losing. It's like, the thing is, it's really understandable for Street Fighter, because, like, Street Fighter fight doesn't take too long.
Yeah.
It's real fast. So if you're quitting one of those, it's like, really? You couldn't sit there for the extra 30 seconds for the guy to finish up the last half of your health bar? You could have just stood still and let him do a combo on you.
It's
right?
Because some games are poorly designed. Like old Mario Kart on the DS, if you quit, it didn't really count as a loss.
Mm-hmm.
So if you had a good record, you just quit any match you're losing immediately.
That is true. In the Blizzard games and Rocket League stuff, when you quit, it counts as you lose, right? You know, when you push concede in Hearthstone, you don't win.
Yeah.
You lose. It's the same as if you lost.
But with Street Fighter, we know, like Scott said, it's 30 seconds. You're not quitting because you're bored. If you get bored in the last 10 seconds of a game of like, there is something else going on in your brain or life that is a problem.
Right. You're quitting because the thing they should do is that when you quit, it counts as you lose. But they don't do that.
Or they're quitting because they don't want to give you, the winner, the satisfaction. They're basically flipping the table as much as they can. They're rage quitting, and it's like the most they can do to flip you off because they can't actually chat to you usually. Like, they're doing it to hurt you. Now, a lot of people, whenever this comes up, the same thread appears everywhere. And the thread basically is people saying, but my internet connection sucks, so, like, I'll get knocked out of games, and I didn't want to quit, and it's not my fault, and I say, tough luck.
That's right.
Because
if your internet connection is so bad, you can't play these games nicely anyway. You can't have a good experience for yourself, right? A game that needs a constant internet connection. So don't bother playing it because it's not good for you. Go play something else that's not going to be a constant pain in the butt. And also, by you, even if you're not doing it intentionally, if you're constantly disconnecting or your ping is bad, you're ruining the game for your teammates. Right? You're even ruining the game for your opponents because they have a substandard, you know, opponent they're up against, right? You're hurting the game. It doesn't matter if it's intentional or your just internet is bad because you live in a really bad place or it's just bad that day. So, yeah, we're going to punish you. We want you to not be in this game, right? And just have people with good internet connections playing.
This is from a game design perspective. You're trying to keep the health of the game itself to a high level. You're trying to make the experience good for people. So regardless of why another player is making that experience bad or poor for the other players, you need to eliminate that player or eliminate those behaviors or your game is going to be bad.
And also, that's really just an excuse, right? Most people who say this are usually rage quitting 90% of the time. And like, how often does your internet really kick you out of a game? Not often, right? If your internet is normal.
And what was the last sentence?
Matt. Oh, you want me to read this? I hope there's sufficiently robust code in this update. I'll read it in the proper voice. I hope that there is sufficiently robust code in this update to make reasonably reliable decisions. This guy totally wears a fedora. On whether a disconnect is intentional or whether it is due to an actual network issue.
Obviously,
someone who quits the game is easy to detect, but I'd hate to see them also treat someone who loses internet connection goes down the what?
Goes down the same. Yeah, we're saying we should treat someone whose internet connection goes down the same as someone who quits on purpose.
Right? He even knows! Yes, I know this means some people could still rage quit by purposely dropping their internet connection. It's you! It's you! You will literally see a paragraph almost identical to this as the first comment on every article in the entire internet about shaming people or punishing people for rage quitting. Matchmaking. I realized after the fact I could have made this a loss edit, and I feel like I'm going to.
Right.
At the next.
So matchmaking goes back to what I was talking about before with like LeBron and Michael Jordan, right? It's like if matchmaking in a game is not good, you can often be up against opponents who you shouldn't be up against and make the game unfun even though the game is otherwise not a problem, right? So Hearthstone has this problem where they de-rank everyone at the beginning of the season and you go in there and there's some, you're like rank 20 and some legend guy comes through and he's got all these crazy fucking cards and you're like, well, I pay this for free and I have like one legendary card and whoa, look at that, I don't even know what the hell that is and I lose, why did I play this?
Now there are objective or at least reasonably objective and mathematical ways to calculate skill in different games. Like these are graphs from a paper talking about Microsoft TrueSkill. You can just implement TrueSkill in your game. Like, you can use the math that other people have done to balance and matchmake your games.
Almost every game that has matchmaking out there, where your rank goes up and down, Rocket League, and everything, you know, they're all using Microsoft TrueSkill or some variation of Microsoft TrueSkill. They basically all read the same mathematical paper and tweaked it a bit to, you know, for their game specifically.
Now, there's an interesting problem here, because good matchmaking will prevent a lot of rage quitting and boredom and fears of cheaters and all this nonsense. But perfect matchmaking actually makes players very unsatisfied with games. Because if matchmaking was 100% magically perfect, you will never experience getting better at the game ever.
Right. So my skill is going up, but now I'm playing against different people, but they're all, whoever I'm playing against is always just about as good as I am, which means I'm going to win about half the time. Always. I'm never going to suddenly get like a ton of wins, right? That doesn't happen because I'm always playing against people who are about as good as me. I'm never playing against people weaker than me, which means I'm not going to just roll them over. I'm never playing against people way better than me, and I'm not going to get bowled over myself. It's always like this 50% win rate. So even though your skill is going up, you're getting the same amount of wins all the time, and you don't feel like you're getting better. If you compare this to something like a real professional sports league, right? 1 year, your team is really good. You know, suddenly you're on the new eight, you get traded to the Patriots, and you're just like, win. Ah, this is so great, right? You know, then the Cleveland Browns are out there going, lose. Right? It's much, and you have to play, they have to play each other because it's a league where everyone has to play each other. Right?
Now, in the old days of baseball, people would just like go home all the time.
There's no matchmaking in baseball.
Yeah, but like in like olden times, baseball in this like professional baseball in the US, teams would just be like, you know what? We're just not going to play against them because they're too good. Screw you.
What's the point?
Yeah. That does not happen anymore. Basically stopped happening after the, like, 1950s. But the solution to that? Like, because if you have that perfect matchmaking, you know Smurfs, people who make a new account so they can play against Scrubs? It's because they want to feel that experience being new in the Matrix. Occasionally when I'm playing Overwatch or Counter-Strike, like, it won't find a good game, and it'll put me with the angriest people in the world from before. I'm just walking around like a god, like I choose that you shall die, and you shall live, and you shall die. And, oh, is that an AWP? I'm just going to walk towards you like Ernest P. Worrell in Ernest Goes to Camp because I know that you can't actually hit me. Only a few people laughed at that. So, actually, good matchmaking causes smurfing, which sucks. So, I can't tell you who does this, but there are real game companies where their internal documentation, they study this, and their actual response is that the matchmaking is made a little bit bad on purpose. They add a fuzziness. They will make sure that you will occasionally run into an opponent who is vastly better than you. Because what that means is you'll get those highs and lows.
You'll get to see what that looks like.
Yep.
Right? It's like, what does it look like when someone just pulls you over? Oh, I see. That's what I have to achieve next, right? That's the level I have to get to. You can see the future of where you need to go.
But if you're good, it'll also remind you, like, yeah, you feel like you're not good at this game. Here's you 5 years ago. This is what you're playing against now. See, they don't know how to make D.Va fly yet. So this literally happens. A lot of the games you play, the matchmaking will occasionally purposefully, grossly mismatch you. That isn't just like a fluke. That is happening on purpose because people study this shit. Anti-cheating tools are a big deal. I don't think any... How many of you played, like, Quake 1, Quake 2 Deathmatch back in the day?
When there were no anti-cheating tools.
You could, like, people cheated all the time.
Constantly. And the cheats were ridiculous cheats. Like, oh, I just click a few times and everyone dies and I'm invincible and I'm moving too fast.
I wrote a script in Quake 2 that gave me offhanded grenades. So I could hit.
So he could be shooting his gun and throwing grenades at the same time.
It was a script. It was like I had the right number of pause statements in. There's a whole scripting language in Quake 2. You could bind them to keys. I wrote scripts that would do all this nonsense. Is that cheating? I don't know. I did it.
It's in the game.
Yeah, it was in the game.
There was no anti-cheating.
Punkbuster appeared and started changing everything. Basically, people started running software on their servers, and they would tell you, if you want to play on my server that I'm hosting, you've got to run the software on your computer, and it's going to watch you to see if you're cheating. And you had to form these cliques. Like, I knew the IP addresses of servers I could join where they had a zero cheater tolerance policy, and I could play there safely. Couldn't play out in the wild. All aim bots. Nowadays, you really can't cheat, and cheaters just get banned. Like Blizzard, if you cheat at a Blizzard game, they just take the game away. They ban you, and that's it. And if you appeal it, they just kind of laugh.
Yeah.
So, probably even more important are the anti-harassment tools. You need to build tools into your game to report and deal with people who are harassing, and this is a super complex problem, because if people get harassed, they'll quit. Harassers, if they get stopped, will quit. You want one of those populations to quit your game, and you want the other one to not quit your game, and hope you can figure out which one's which.
And if your whole community, if all the harassers are there, like every single game, the person will just quit your game entirely, and not just that one match where there was a bad person in it. And then you're losing money. And the next time you put out a game, or you put out a sequel, that person will buy that game, even though they might have liked the game itself, because they have this idea of what it's going to be like to play it.
Remember Heroes of New Earth? We talked about Heroes of New Earth at a PAX panel a long time ago. We talked about the community of that game, And there is this one comment in our YouTube channel to this day where someone's like, you guys are being really unfair to the community of this game. Like, it's not as bad as you say it is. And there's just this thread of people being like, dude, it is literally at the bottom of the internet. The problem with these tools is that harassers are also going to use them, and they're going to accuse the people they're harassing of the same thing that they're accusing them of.
Right, I mean, that's at least with the tool of simply just user reporting, right, only, right? There are other tools that can be used, right, like just monitoring by the people who run the game. You know, you could, I guess you have enough people, you could read all the chats and listen to all the voice chats and find the people who are the harassers and ban them.
Yep.
Right, and that wouldn't be subject to problems of harassers reporting innocent people.
Much more clever is anti-harassment design. Designing a game such that no matter how much of a cockbag the person you're playing with is, they can't get it on you.
Right, the worst that someone can do to you in a game of Hearthstone is say, you know, threaten, push the threaten button. You can't talk. You can't chat with them, right? You know, they can just use the emotes at you, but then you can squelch the emotes. So now they're shut up and they have to just play. And they can let the rope go every turn, in which case I'm like, oh, you're going to rope me, eh? I'll wait for your rope. Bring it on. All right, yeah, go ahead with that rope. You're going to lose this game. You're wasting your time. You can just let me win and concede anytime you want. And then I win.
So a really subtle example of this, in Overwatch, if you type certain phrases, like GGEZ, like right after you beat someone, you're like, GGEZ, it just changes your text to like, I'm sorry that I am such an antisocial disappointment. And the way the community has evolved around that, because I like to trash talk, like, when I'm playing with my friends, like, that's a thing we do. But in Overwatch, trash talking sort of evolved, where people will say GG, like, good game, as trash talk. Like, they'll say, good game, a minute before the match ends. But think about what happens. Like, yeah, it's trash talk. Like, I'm doing it to be kind of a jerk. But the action I took is I said good game. It's like it's gone through this filter. And even if you recognize, oh, that guy's a jerk and he said it early, the thing he said was good game. Like, it's
right.
Kind of an objective thing.
As long as
okay
the person doesn't
say,
like, you all guys suck and racist slur and sexist slur, right? As long as they don't say that, if they say GG, the person on the other end might say, oh, GG. They might not see that sarcasm because it's text on the internet. So it really depends on you when you see a text like that. If you recognize whether, you know, do you perceive that? And it's like, you might even see someone say GG a minute early and think, that jerk. But really, they were just saying GG. They could have been. And you were just had such a pessimistic view of humanity that you thought that person was a harasser, but they weren't. So, eye of the beholder.
Culture. So, this is a gaming con. Does anyone know who Vince Lombardi is?
I mean, we talk about football enough today,
okay,
right?
Okay.
But anyway, in the United States especially, but I think in the world in general, and, you know, generally in, you know, sexist world, right, you know, quitting is like a bad thing, especially for men,
yep.
Right?
Men don't quit, winners win!
Yeah! It's like, quitting is like this bad thing. Like, if you're the quitter, then you're bad, right? And I think we've talked today about how, you know, a lot of reasons why quitting is not bad. Right? But, like, this culture of, like, quitting as a bad thing, not just at games, but, like, at life, it's like, oh, you have your dream, you should never give up on it. It's like, no, sometimes you should give up. And it's totally cool to give up, and it's not a problem, and you shouldn't be shamed for giving up, and you shouldn't be looked down upon for giving up, right? Quitting is often an intelligent decision, and something we never do is say, good job quitting. Who says that? Even though there's a lot of times you should. Like, you see someone, like, struggling with something that you know they can never do, like playing basketball against LeBron when they're only 4 feet tall.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's like they're just suffering and they're not happy, but they just can't quit because they can't quit for cultural reasons, right? There's a huge pressure to not quit at things in general. When someone quits intelligently, we should be like, that was good.
Yeah.
You should have quit. Good. You should. Yes. Good. Correct. Good
now,
move.
A counterpoint.
No one says that.
Is that within individual games or individual sports, the culture of professionalism and sportsmanship could also prevent rage quitters without having this like over masculine nonsense. Like, for example, if you have like a pickup league of hockey, maybe you all take it seriously enough where like no one's gonna quit the games. Like, everyone's like, we're playing this together. This is a thing. Don't quit. And that's sort of like That honor code of a sport could prevent quitting.
Right.
You want to encourage that good kind of culture of, like, this mutually consensual culture around not quitting without making it the sort of obligatory construct that makes people play against racists.
I think one thing we do see is this sort of sense of, like, honorable quitting. Like, oh, I recognize your mastery, right? Now, that's not the master saying, good job quitting, but you're still, like, honorably, like, conceding. Like, yes, you are better than me, right? Like, at chess, you'll just, like, knock your king over and be like, all right, congratulations, right? Or, like, martial arts, you'd be like, all right, you have bested me. You are the master.
So where do we go with all this? We literally have 2 minutes left, and the summary of this panel is very simple. One, quit it. Games are not real life. You can quit games. If you can't quit them, they're not games. If you design games, you have to at least consider the idea that someone might quit your game in the middle of it, and you have to decide how you want that experience to play out for all involved. Generally, don't quit games. Like, if you commit to a game and you're playing it with people and they don't do something, like, really racist or sexist or dumb or, like just play the game to the end if it's not going to hurt you because you agreed to it.
Right. I mean, you think about it. Like, if you're just playing a normal game, you think about what quitting's going to do. It's going to be like, okay, you're going to sit there for how much more longer and whether how much fun is it for you, but how much are these people who seem to want to play? But you can verify. You can be like, hey, does everyone still want to play this? Do you mind if I quit? And if they say, yeah, we really want to continue, you know, you got to weigh what's going on, but in general, don't just quit because rage, you know, like the rage quitters are punishing them for a reason. Right?
Sometimes quit games. If you're sitting down for a game at MAGFest and they say it's going to take 2 hours and you've hit the 3 hour mark and it's not even halfway done, I urge you to quit that game for your own health and sanity.
If you got legit reasons, you know, even though we shouldn't generally quit, when you got a legit reason, you absolutely got to quit. Right?
Yep. If you're addicted to a game, if a game is having an undue and negative impact on your life, you really need to try to recognize that. Like, if someone points out, like, yo, dog, you stopped feeding your kids, like, a month ago, and you're just playing Overwatch.
You've been, like, here, you've been at that Civ since, like, 2 a.m. yesterday. You should stop. You haven't eaten anything.
Do you even have a hotel room here?
Yeah. It's like, you know, if you need to be able to recognize, like, even if you're having fun, and even if the game is good and you're playing it too much, quitting is often a good idea, right? And if someone does, you know, especially in this case, if you see someone quit for this reason, you need to acknowledge to them, like, good job quitting, right? Yes, you should have quit that, you know? Like, if someone's quit smoking, it's like, good, yes, that's a good thing, congratulations.
Oh, no, but now they're vaping.
Oh, no. Stop poisoning yourselves.
Gaming culture, we are very invested in the idea of never quit at games. We've talked about all this time. I urge you, if someone is engaging in bad behavior, particularly the kinds of bad behaviors that are so endemic in gaming right now, quit and tell them why. And tell everyone at the table why. Walk away from that shit. Because it's hard to find games. We have a whole lecture on
YouTube. You
might have
to do other things, but also do this.
We have this whole lecture on YouTube about how hard it is to find games. Because it's so hard to find people to play the games you like with in society. Like, you know, like if you're into like Bushido Blade, if you find another human being who also likes Bushido Blade, you want to play Bushido Blade with them. And if it turns out they're really racist, don't play Bushido Blade with them.
Even though there's no one else on Earth to play with, it's better off to just not play Bushido Blade.
And we're out of time!
All right, we quit. Now Rim's gonna put on a hot dog costume.
If you would like to see videos of many of these lectures,
if you want to see Rim in a hot dog costume, wait like 5 minutes.
Yeah, that's going to happen too. But grab one of these flyers. There are links to YouTube videos of many of the panels we have done over time. And I'm going to be on the horror sounds panel tonight.